So let's talk about alignment for a minute. Let's talk about, you started in your beginning a monologue about like, there's partners have autonomy, okay? Partners have their own clients, okay? They have their skill set. There's a certain degree of autonomy that accountants, lawyers, doctors, these people have. One of the reasons they went into the profession, because they don't really necessarily want to be told what to do so much, okay? So how do you get alignment? How do you get there?
I think it starts with building real relationships with people. You know, everybody's had a coach, whether it's in school or sports or life. The first thing you build on is, can I open up to this person? Do they truly care about me? Do they see my greatness? Do they challenge me and hold me accountable for my actions? Those are the grassroots fundamentals that you need. Now, that doesn't mean in a big firm the leader has to align with everyone. They have to have, you know, the other leaders that handle that. But that's the foundation. You know, I do a lot of leadership succession. And, you know, when we get into what we call the elimination round, you know, the first round is put your name in. There's a couple, you know, we talk to offset and we just say, not happening. Like, let's not even go there. But there's some, and invariably, there's two things they have to have. They have to have the trust of a majority of the partners. There's probably a couple that don't trust them. You know, sometimes in the fray, in the battle, things happen. They also have to have a majority that respect their business savviness. Those are the things. The next level, if they survive that, is they have to, I think to some degree, they have to be a student of the business.
Mm-hmm.
They understand the industry, the changes, the opportunities, the dynamics. Do they then have the ability to make tough decisions, fast decisions, tough decisions, lots of decisions, consensus up to a point, but at some point, make a bloody decision. And as we've talked about many times, just get them a little bit more right than wrong. Then the next step of it is, what are they giving up? I mean, take a high performer, right? And move them out of the street and bring them into the tower. Who's going to replace what they did? Sometimes leaving the leader there is the best thing we can do. And sometimes just because they're good at getting business, winning clients, serving clients, technically sharp, doesn't mean they're going to be a great leader.
So let's go on that subject. That's actually further down in my list.
Yeah, but, yeah.
You know, I'll analogize it to lawyers. I think it's the same thing. Like, a lawyer doesn't usually want a leader who isn't in that partner's view as good as him as a lawyer. It's just a thing, okay? Yeah. Someone who didn't get business, someone who wasn't a great technician, or some aspect of the practice. And like you said, that may or may not have anything to do with leadership, but it does have something to do with respect, deference, something. Like, how do you sort of think about people viewing, partners viewing potential leaders in a way that's related to how good of accountants they are?
Yeah, how good technically they are at doing
technically or getting business.
It's absurd. How come non-CPAs and non-attorneys can go into America's top 100 accounting and law firms and excel? And they've never worked in the factory making the car. It's because they have great leadership skills, strategic thinking, and the ability to inspire and make decisions.
Okay.
And hold others accountable.
So let's go to sort of how do you get stuff done?
Yeah.
Okay. So inspiration is part of it. Okay. But a lot of times in accounting firms, I think all professional service firms, things just don't, it sounds a great idea. We're all jazzed up. Nothing happens. Like, how do you get from point A to point B?
Yeah. So the four corner offense, this is really important in any leadership structure. The power and authority that the CEO will have, the power and authority that the board will have, power and authority that the department heads will retain and the power and authority that the entire partner group will have. Who makes what decisions when? Levenfeld Perlstein, build for speed, right?
Yes.
You cut out all the clutter. The partners understand and trust that they're going to put the best people in place, and we're going to give them our input. We may not agree with them, but the show goes on. Go make your decision, and we will support it. No Monday morning quarterbacks. I think there's a lot of great leaders in our profession that, unfortunately, the playing field, their deck of cards, it's flawed. They can't excel. They can't soar. I also believe that there's some leaders out there that they've given them the power, and they're not comfortable with it. It's be careful what you wish for.
So talk a little bit about the managing partner bringing the executive committee along, or vice versa. You know, I'll leave it at that.
Yeah, I think there's two kinds of, let's use the words executive committee and board in the same, the same definition. The question that needs to get defined on day one is, are they an advisor to the managing partner?
Mm-hmm.
Or does the managing partner report to the board and the board makes the decisions? This is just the person that carries things out. Fundamental, but critical. I personally believe that the board should be an advisor to the CEO. Up to a point. If the entire board is pushing back on something, the CEO has to understand that probably not smart to go run with that decision if I don't have the support of my lieutenants. But let's face it, most board members, I mean, look, if I was hired to go in, I go into these board of directors and I whisper to the managing partner, are you kidding me? Like, why is that person here? Why is this person here? Well, you know, our partnership agreement says you need one from each major service line. Mm-hmm. So we have somebody from audit, tax, and consulting, and then we have three people from each of the offices. I said, well, how's this? To be on the board, you have to be a role model. You have to be a high-performing partner and respected by your peers. You have to be able to think strategically. You have to be a student of the profession. You have to know as much about the competition as us consultants know. And you have to be able to think strategically, and then you have to be an ambassador, because what gets decided in that room, you as the congressperson or senator have to go back and influence your constituencies. That's the job description of a board or executive committee member. What have we put on here? You put department heads or industry leaders or office leaders. They don't have that skill set. And then once in a while, you'll see a crazy on the board. And I'm like, oh, my God, what's that person doing here? And they laugh and they say, well, you know, we just decided it's better to have him or her in the room than not.
Mm-hmm.
That's a criteria. So it's a loaded question, but it starts with what's the relationship, power, authority, decision making to the board, to the CEO? And then what does the board and CEO decide versus the entire partner group?